expired on March 1st, and I neglected to thank him. And I would like to do that tonight and to say that he is really going to be missed. If you're watching us on television, Dan, we really appreciated your contribution to this board, your innate intelligence, how much you cared about your town, and we also appreciate how much you have given of yourself, not only to this planning board, but also on the Comprehensive Planning Commission. We wish you well, and I think that you would have made an excellent chairperson. Dan really should have been the chair this year, but the rigors of his work and his responsibilities at work prevented that. But I think, Dan, if you're watching, you would have been a superb chair, and you will really be missed, and we thank you very, very much. Anyone else want to say anything about Dan?
Madam Chairman, only that you covered it all and very well. Dan has been a tremendous member of the board for the last several years, and he will be sorely missed.
Thank you. I was, just as an aside, at one of our workshop meetings, we were discussing the changes, the entire board. Dan was not with us. I guess he had to work that evening. And, you know, I was explaining to the new people that Dan should have been the chair, but because he couldn't assume the chair, that I had to. But I thought that he would have been a much better chair. But Steve Edsel said, but Marion, he wouldn't have told all of your stories that you tell. So at any rate, he will be missed. And now I take great pride and pleasure in introducing some new people to our board. You will have to bear with us with people coming and going. It's a little confusing. But on my left is Janet McCaw, who has been appointed as a full voting member to replace Dan Boxer. Janet is an attorney. We've had two orientations with our new members. I also went on a site walk with Janet and really got to know her a few Sundays ago and took her over to the Highlands. And I think she is going to be an excellent member of this board. We welcome you, Janet. In addition, I would like to announce that Judith Kane, as of this very moment, becomes a full voting member, and she will fill the unexpired term of Alice Rand. Stephen Edsel becomes a full voting member following our election this evening. He is filling my unexpired term. I stayed a month too long, and Steve probably should have been a full voting member right now. In addition, the town council has appointed to a one-year term Thomas Emery to my right. Tom will serve as an associate this evening, and he will be joined next month by a gentleman sitting in our audience, Gilman Angier Jr., otherwise known as Jerry. It's easy to remember the two of them because they are Tom and Jerry.
Fame comes so easily sometimes.
Tom is a landscape architect and will bring that expertise to this board. And Jerry has formerly served on the South Portland Planning Board, so he brings a lot of knowledge of what goes on at these complicated sessions. So we welcome you, and we hope that you will be very happy. This evening, in the absence of Ivan Most, who is probably running a little late, he teaches at the university. Steve, would you please vote for Ivan? Okay. Okay, and I would also like to say that this is my last meeting. It is a passage for me, and I would like to thank this board for the pleasure and the honor of serving with them. I have a high regard and a great affection for all of you. I wish you well, because this is an awesome responsibility, because what we plan is forever. And I want to particularly thank all of the board members, and to my right, Alice Allen, who has been an outstanding secretary and a lovely human being, and to my left, Steve, who is still going about doing things, our planner. He is like a third son to me. I worry about him if he doesn't put his coat on, you know, when he goes out in the cold. He has certainly been very helpful to me, and I would also like to say a special thanks to Jerry Daigle and Ernie McBain, who have helped me numerous times, to the excellent warm staff at the town hall, especially Deborah Pizzo and Barbara Jordan, and to the TV crew, and to George, who is ever gracious to all of us. I thank you very much, but I won't be gone until it all ends. So I'm going to work till the end. On the minutes of the previous meeting, do I hear a motion to waive the reading of the minutes of the February 20th meeting?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, raise your hand, please. Opposed? It's unanimous. Are there any additions or corrections to those minutes? Hearing none, do I hear a motion to accept the minutes of the February 20th meeting? Do I hear that motion?
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Oh, thank you, Janet. All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? That, too, is unanimous. On correspondence, I received the February issue of the Maine Townsman. I received approximately four or maybe six legislative reports from Senator Barbara Gill. February 27th from COG, a notice announcing a comprehensive planning workshop. A notice from the Quebec delegation and the Chamber of Commerce concerning a breakfast meeting on March 23rd. On February 15th, a notice from COG concerning a meeting on local economy on February 28th. A meeting notice from Mike McGovern for April 3rd, 7:30 p.m. for all board chairpersons. I have passed that on to Dick Tinsman. February 1st, a letter from George J. Marcus, 1 Ragosa Way, Cape Elizabeth. This is a third letter from Mr. Marcus regarding his claim of a right-of-way across the proposed project, the Highlands of Broad Cove. Mr. Marcus advises us that the matter remains unresolved between himself and Mr. Kennedy, and that the planning board should be aware of this lack of resolution. In correspondence, previous correspondence, I have also acknowledged previous letters from Mr. Marcus dated April 17th, 1989, and July 24th, 1989, addressed to Gerald Daigle Town Hall, and one dated March 23rd, 1989, addressed to Mr. Kennedy. I also brought for the board, which I dug out of my voluminous files, a letter from the town attorney dated January 31st, 1990. I thought that we had had some communication with the town attorney on this matter. And in the third paragraph, Michael Hill states that with regard to the existing 25-foot right-of-way shown on the plan, we feel the legal implications of the right-of-way are more of a potential purchaser's issue rather than a planning board issue. And then Michael goes on to say that we may wish to require that a notation be placed on the plan showing which lots are affected by the right-of-way, and that we may further wish to require that unless the lots are released from the right-of-way, each deed shall recite a description of the easement and a book and page reference to its source. So that is all explained. February 21st, a letter from the Belfield Association signed by Peter Berg, the president, addressing concerns about drainage problems that could occur in Cranbrook on lots that abut Stonegate 4. A notice from COG announcing a spring conference, which some of you might be interested in attending, on April 13th from 8:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the Holiday Inn. A letter dated March 13th, which I just received today, sent to the superintendent of the Maine Department of Transportation with carbon copies to Chief Pickering and to me from Dr. Frederick K. Poulin, I think that's the pronunciation, or maybe it's Poulin, Jr., M.D., 58 Two Lights Road, citing the following concerns about Two Lights Road. I am being a little more verbose about this because this letter, I think, is important to the board, and since we don't have time to read this correspondence, I want to tell you a little bit about it. His concerns are the posted speed is too fast, there is very heavy traffic caused by the State Park restaurant, coupled with pedestrians, bicyclists, strawberry pickers, and deer. Dr. Poland reported the death of a child and numerous accidents, including several turnovers of cars at the curve adjacent to Wheeler Road at the northern end of Two Lights Road. There is flooding of the road, and the doctor feels that that proposes dangers. And the new connector road proposed for the Highlands at Broad Cove predicts a great increase in vehicular traffic and a growing use by more pedestrian traffic. Dr. Poland makes six suggestions for enhancing safety. These suggestions include a solid line for no passing, lower the speed limit to 30 miles per hour, more speed enforcement on the road, a culvert to mitigate the drainage problems. The construction of a breakdown lane should be constructed to improve safety for pedestrians and bicyclists, and a deer crossing sign should be posted. That letter was dated March 16th. Oh, I'm sorry, that was March 13th. In addition, today I received a four-page letter, a copy of it, from Chief Pickering. That letter was dated March 16th, and it responds to Dr. Poulin's concerns. So you should receive a copy of that as well. If you don't have it on your desk now, I did give it to Steve. So that is the correspondence for this evening. First on the agenda of old business, the Highlands at Broad Cove, a 20-lot major subdivision. At our last meeting last month, the Planning Board found just cause to extend the hearing on the wetlands alteration permit. So we will continue that this evening, and I would like to ask the applicant if there is anything he would like to say briefly for the benefit of people who are attending this week who did not, who aren't filled in on this application. Would your applicant briefly like to explain what this alteration entails?
I think it would be best if Scott Decker explained the changes in the plan and how they affect what.
Well, we're working right now on the wetlands alteration permit.
Correct.
And all we would like is just a brief summary of what you plan to alter so that the people who wish to speak this evening will know what they're speaking about, and that's it. We'll take up the preliminary plan afterwards, okay? And welcome back from vacation, Mr. Kennedy. We were very envious of you thinking that you were probably lying in the sun last month. Mr. Decker.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. For those who may not be familiar with the project, let me just very briefly identify the major wetland areas and the impacts on them. The areas you see shaded in green here are the areas that have been mapped as wetlands. And I should point out that the areas have been mapped by five or six different consultants at this point. And the wetlands that we're showing here do not necessarily comply with each and every consultant's mapped wetland, but it does include everything that has been mapped by all of the consultants as wetland, including several gray areas that nobody was quite sure if it was wetland or not. Thought that possibly in the spring of the year we would get a better idea. We've gone ahead and mapped it as wetlands just in case. The entrance off from Two Lights Road, this is Two Lights Road here. We have an entrance called Farm Pond Road, which comes in from Two Lights, takes a swing up, and ties into Hunts Point Road Extension. Now, this is a road that we're running through the project primarily for the benefit of the community to provide another access to the Broad Cove area. It would have been just as easy for the applicant to have put a couple of short cul-de-sacs accessing the property, but that would not have provided the through road that we feel as though the town really needs. And you can see that by doing this, there's a fairly significant piece of wetland here that is crossed. In fact, that's about a half-acre portion of wetland right there. There's another small piece, or a couple of small pieces, that are crossed going up to the Hunts Point Road Extension, this area right here. Actually, this is about the same amount of wetland that would be disturbed if we went straight through the site and connected down to Winding Way Road, which was at one time a consideration. From Hunts Point Road going up to the Phase 2 portion of the site, we've also got a small 50-foot right-of-way that we're passing through, and there is a significant amount of that section of the right-of-way that is also wetland, and we would be passing through there. This plan that you see here is somewhat different than the one that we have brought before the planning board previously, in that two additional fingers of wetland have arisen in the last month or so, and we are bringing the roads around those portions of wetland so that they are not disturbed by the access roads. Down in this location, we have Channel View Road, an extension that comes in to service three of the lots, and actually four of the lots here. And there's a small, narrow strip of wetland that is disturbed off the end of the cul-de-sac, and actually two very small pieces that are disturbed a hundredth of an acre just due to the extent of the cul-de-sac. All in all, there's approximately three-quarters of an acre of wetland that's being disturbed, and approximately 65 hundredths of that three-quarters of an acre is in the two access roads. And the locations are pretty well tied down just by the amount of land that the applicant owns.
Thank you, Mr. Decker. I will now open up the public hearing. There are just a few rules. Please try to be as brief as possible so that everyone has an opportunity to speak. Try not to repeat what your neighbor has said, and don't be nervous. With that, I will open up the public hearing. Is there anyone from the public who would like to comment? Louise Sullivan? Oh.
From this vantage point, the whole body part
Mr. Decker, do you think that you could just move the map just for now? Thank you so much. Thanks. Can you see it now in the audience?
Can the board see it?
And can the board see it? Maybe if we moved it.
Could put it in back.
Mm-hmm. Okay, they have a map there, so that's great. Thanks again, Mr. Decker and Mr. Kennedy. Is there anyone from a public who would like to comment on this? Yes, Dr. Sullivan.
My name's Richard Sullivan. I'd first like to thank the Planning Board for the time and care they've taken in considering this very complicated project and for the attention they've given to the public input in the project. I have three areas of concern regarding this project and wetlands. And perhaps I could move this back so I can comment on that. The first is the fact that Mr. Kennedy's wetlands map is now shows a much larger area than he proposed last fall. And this is the result of the oversight from the wetlands experts that the town and the neighborhood hired. We can see that these new areas of wetlands, to use their term, keep arising. And this raises several concerns in my mind. First of all, will we find further areas of wetland when we're able to scrutinize this area more carefully in the spring? We see these fingers that come down this far, and these were discovered in the dead of winter. Will there be, and when we're able to analyze these areas more carefully, will these fingers extend across these roads which keep changing to conform to the changing wetlands boundaries? And my second area of concern regarding the changing wetlands map is the fact that if Mr. Kennedy is so underreported this important wetlands data, can we believe his other data? I wonder, has he fudged on his septic system report so that he's able to pass them all marginally? Can we believe his community impact statement? I feel that Mr. Kennedy's credibility is seriously challenged by his underreporting of the wetlands, which was only corrected by the town's experts. My second area of concern is the proposed road between Hunts Point Road and Two Lights Road. And in fact, we now have a newly discovered wetlands through which this road travels, I feel we have to ask again the question, what is the justification for a road of this size, a full access road with a 50-foot right-of-way through a major wetlands? The town has given us two reasons for justifying this large road. First of all is the need for a second access for emergency vehicles. And the second reason is the necessity to relieve congestion on Broad Cove Road. Now, we all agree on the necessity for a second access for emergency vehicles. But we ask, why can't this be accomplished by a one-lane road limited only to emergency vehicles? The town's answer is that a road of this nature will be blocked with stacked wood and parked boats. But I don't find this argument very convincing. It seems to me that the neighbors in this area will want this road, this right-of-way, to remain open for their own public safety. And furthermore, the public safety officials, the police, will be able to drive through this right-of-way in their daily rounds and certainly assure that it stays open. The second argument that the town has made is that this road is necessary to relieve traffic on Broad Cove Road. But they really haven't shown that there is any less congestion on Two Lights Road, where they propose to route the Broad Cove traffic. As others have mentioned, Two Lights Road is also a narrow road with no sidewalks, with houses close to the road. Two Lights Road serves a cul-de-sac of more than 100 houses. And in addition, we have, as you know, a state park, a high-volume restaurant, and a lighthouse attraction, not to mention the strawberry fields. A police survey last summer showed the average speed on Two Lights Road to be 38 miles an hour, whereas the study this winter showed the average speed on Broad Cove Road to be 29 miles an hour. In 1988 and 1989, there were 5 accidents on Two Lights Road in the stretch between the proposed egress and Route 77. Two of these were from deer, and as we know, the deer population being on the increase, this is likely to continue to be a problem. So I ask, why should we construct a large road through major wetlands in order to route traffic from one congested road to another, especially when this will lead to the creation of a third congested road, which will be Hunts Point Road Extension? I feel that the newly identified wetlands is a further reason to limit the road to the smallest size, which will assure public safety. A single lane right-of-way, perhaps with a locked gate, would assure public safety and would give us the minimum impact on this wetlands area. This isn't a novel idea. In the city of Portland, they commonly use one-lane locked gates as a second access for large developments. My last concern regarding the wetlands in this project is this wetlands, which perhaps the applicant will be donating to the town. At the last meeting, there was some confusion whether he had withdrawn this application. I know he does not want to comply with the Conservation Commission's request that he grant a public right-of-way along the edge of this donated wetlands, which the commission felt was important, since it doesn't lend itself to through pedestrian traffic. And I won't comment on the fact that this boggy, brushy area really isn't an appropriate site for neighborhood recreation as defined by the comprehensive plan. I'm more concerned with the lack of rights of way through the project. And it isn't really clear to me what rights of way the developer has proposed. We see in yellow this traditional right of way, but it follows straight across several of his properties, and I'm not sure that he's really proposing that the public have access through these ways. In fact, I'm worried that this will be a right of way perhaps only to those with a deeded access from Channel View, and that many residents of Broad Cove will have no through access through the project. We see also that there is no public right-of-way through Phase 1, so it seems that the only people who will be able to enjoy the rare plants and black ducks in these ponds areas are the owners of lots 1 and 2. It isn't even clear that the owners of lots 13 and 14 and 12 will have any public right-of-way through to this cul-de-sac. We've met with Mr. Kennedy and his lawyer and expressed our concerns regarding the rights-of-way, and I know that the Planning Board has also expressed concern as to the lack of donation of public wetlands, of wetlands area to the town. And in spite of our dialogue, both from the Planning Board and the neighborhood, we've really made no headway in this area. It seems to me that Mr. Kennedy's property would lose very little value if he gave us these public rights of way, and certainly they would add a great deal of value to the neighborhood and to the town. But he's really been unwilling to bend on this or any other issue, and his attitude has been, this is my plan, take it or leave it. We don't oppose any development in this land, but we do oppose this particular plan. We've tried to give Mr. Kennedy input, as to how ways that we feel this plan may be adapted in easy ways to fit the needs of the neighborhood, and really there's been no change whatsoever. So I urge the planning board to reject Mr. Kennedy's plan tonight. Perhaps if you do so, then we can begin to have, perhaps then he will start listening to the planning board's inputs and perhaps the input from the neighborhood, and we can, the next time around, achieve a plan which will be acceptable both to the town and the neighborhood as well as the developer. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sullivan.
Madam Chairman,
yeah.
I think it should be clear, however, that this is a public hearing on the wetland alteration permit application.
Right.
And that I would request that the chair request speakers to hold their views strictly to the application before us for the public hearing.
Right.
And we've heard many of the arguments before. We'll have our own thoughts tonight on much of the input that we've already received.
Correct. Yes. When you speak, if you come to the microphone, please make your comments relate to the wetlands alteration permit, because that's what we're here for tonight. We've already had two public hearings on the preliminary plan. Is there someone else from the audience who has something to add to what Dr. Sullivan has just said? Something different to say about the wetlands alteration? Yes, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening. Please state your name.
Luck, Marion.
Thank you. Could you please state your name?
Yeah, my name is Dick Page. I live at 54 Hunts Point Road. And my lot is, you can see it over here, right here on Hunts Point Road. And as Dick Sullivan has pointed out, the wetlands grow and grow and grow, and now we're in the second day of spring. I think it would behoove this committee to hold off any decision concerning this project until you get a better look at what spring is going to bring. This area has grown, as has been pointed out by the developer, mostly due to the town and our people looking into the wetlands, not by his own. And as Mr. Sullivan had pointed out, I think it should be again looked at when the land is wet, and it's wet now. I was one of the first houses on the extension of Hunts Point Road. I have a couple of concerns of what happens after this process is approved. My house is a good example of what happens, and when we moved in, it was laid out where our septic system should be, where we had to have our septic system, and we did indeed put our house in abeyance with the septic system where the town had recommended where it had tested. The problem that we had is we went by the town rules. Other people moved into the neighborhood, and the town decided to give some exceptions to the rules and allowed people to move their septic systems. In doing so, they allowed a natural flow behind our lot, which it shows part of it here, but it doesn't quite show, we were calling it on Golden Muck the other day. What had happened is there used to be a natural flow through the back of our yard. And it was no more than, let's say, 3 feet wide. And again, that didn't bother us. We knew when we bought the lot what was there, and it did flow in the spring, and it dried up pretty much in the summertime. What has happened is now that the town is away from it and they've approved everything, they let people come in and fill in the way they wanted to fill in, and now that stream or natural flow is now on Golden Muck, and it stays that way all year long. So from 3 feet, I've got about 10 to 12 feet wide, and up in this area here, it's also been cut off So now we have a real water problem in that whole area. My concern is it's going to happen again. We called Ernie McVane out and said, Ernie, what can we do before people started to fill in? And nothing happened. After it was filled in, we called out Mike McGovern, who looked at the site, and said, well, now you have a civil problem. Well, this problem was pointed out before it became a civil problem. And I'm very concerned when I see the wetlands here that the same thing is going to happen when this plan is approved. And the wetlands keep growing. And as people start building, they'll start filling. And if I'm not mistaken, and correct me if I'm wrong, the Pleasant Wetlands Ordinance allows you to fill in 5,000 feet. Is that correct? If we look in this room and double it and add some more, that's more than 5,000 feet. That's how much somebody can go in and fill in some wetlands today. And there's a lot of wetlands to fill in here. So if I want my house somewhere and move it, I can move it. They'll let me move my septic system because they let my neighbors move it. But if I want a backyard and I have to fill in wetlands, well, now I can do it. And that's what's happened to our property. I can see it happening here. I think it's much too dense for the wetlands that he's presenting. And I have to say that the wetlands are growing as spring is here, and I really wish you would consider that. And I see this plan and disagree with it. I am not against anybody making a living and building, but I feel what I see here is not acceptable to myself, to most of the residents of the area, and I hope not to the planning board, and I don't support it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Page. Yes?
My name is Edward Perry. I live at 10 Pine Ridge Road. I have many concerns about problems that have been brought to the developer's attention at previous meetings by residents, board members, various advisors to the board. Today, many of the problems still remain unaddressed and unsolved. I'd just like to talk about a few of them that relate to the wetlands and some of them that just happen to relate to exactly what Mr. Page said. On September 11th, 1989, Bob Hunter, the town engineer, wrote a letter to Stephen Butler. The letter was concerned with, at the beginning, on-site waste disposal and wells and how they would be incompatible. And that problem was solved because Greater Portland Development Group decided not to put the wells in. But the rest of the letter dealt with storm water management. It mentions that because the proposed subdivision plans to use the wetlands in phase two and probably in phase one as a receptacle for runoff, and abutters to the wetlands have already complained about flooding, that it might be prudent to extend the stormwater study to include all of the water courses around Broad Cove, including the stream that runs up in here all the way down to the ocean. This would be especially important now because virtually all of the houses abutting the Phase 2 wetlands, and I don't know how many of the houses abutting the Phase 1 wetlands, will be unable to correct any future drainage problems because they were built before 1976 and will not be grandfathered under the new wetlands ordinance, which places them in the 100-foot buffer zone of a critical wetlands. I believe this problem remains unsolved, and I believe it would also complicate Mr. Page's problem even further. In the same letter, Bob Hunter also questions, with all the easements that it's going to take to run the water off this development, who is going to maintain the easements? Are they going to be large enough for the town to be able to get in a few years, run some machinery through, and clean the drainage easements out? Does the town have the right to direct runoff from one piece of property onto somebody else's private property? I don't believe that either of these problems have been addressed by the developer. Next, Greater Portland Development Group's Squaw Bay Corporation has recommended that four lots, 3N, 13N, 5S, and 6S, be limited to two-bedroom homes because of the marginal soils. In the future, who will see that this recommendation is followed 8 or 10 years from now? Our building inspector is already overburdened. The developer has made no legal provisions to see that these two-bedroom homes are not expanded. It remains as another problem not addressed. 15 of the house lots are on marginal soils. If a sewer system has to be put in to replace failing septic systems, who will pay for the sewer system? The town taxpayers, the homeowners, the developer? These seem to be just a few of the many questions that have surfaced since the introduction of the plan. These questions have accumulated over the long planning process instead of being answered. The problems here will affect Cape Elizabeth residents forever. I think these problems should be answered before any further permits, waivers, or approvals are given. I think it's time to clear the air here. It's time for the planning board to take a stand, put the burden of proof back on the developer by saying no more approvals until we get some solutions. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else from the public? Yes.
Good evening. My name is Gregory Woodworth, and I live at 12 Channelview, which is right here. I spoke last month before the board and addressed a somewhat selfish concern when I asked the board if they would ask the developer what changes to the development of the parcel of land contiguous to mine the developer planned as a result of newfound wetlands on that parcel. And the developer's response was none. And I think that response highlights one of the major problems with this development, and that is that notwithstanding the fact that the wetlands areas have increased dramatically since this development was proposed, there have been no changes proposed by the developer in the number of lots that he plans to develop. And indeed, I don't think there's been any suggestion that he pare back to the original plan of approximately half the number of houses. I took a run on Sunday and meandered my way through the so-called highlands and tried to stay on the highland, and it was somewhat difficult, and by the time I made it to Two Lights Road, I was pretty soaked. And I couldn't help but wonder what would happen to these wetlands and the water in them if 20 houses with 22-car garages, 20 driveways, access roads, and cul-de-sacs were built onto this wetland area. And I think the sad answer is that they would be dramatically altered. And with the alteration of the wetlands comes a dramatic alteration of the wildlife habitat that the wetlands provide. I've run through there and seen deer, fox, ringneck pheasant, all sorts of songbirds, and one has to wonder what will happen to those. With the building of 20 houses and 22-car garages and driveways and cul-de-sacs and access roads, you're also going to see a dramatic change in the water purification effect that wetlands have here. And I wonder if the question of what impact 20 septic systems is going to have on this wetlands has been adequately addressed. As I said, wetlands provides a very substantial water purification effect to this land, and with the septic systems on there, I think that would be dramatically altered. And finally, with the addition of 20 houses and everything else that goes with it, what's going to happen to the flood control effect of the wetlands? Right now, that's a very important aspect of wetlands. And when you go through this property, you see that it's basically ledge and wetlands. And if those wetlands are altered, the water's not going to seep into the ledge. And the question remains, is it going to be seeping into basements that are there, onto roads, et cetera? The chairwoman made an important statement, I think, at the beginning of this meeting when she discussed the awesome responsibility that this board has. And I think those were very accurate words with respect to the consideration of this particular development. I think the responsibility rests with this board, and it is their decision that will have a great impact on whether or not these wetlands survive. And I strongly urge that this application be rejected. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Woodworth. Anyone? This is a great audience here tonight. I'm sure performers would love you.
Madam Chairman,
yes?
I think it would be appropriate to ask the people here not to express their favor with speakers that might be talking during the public hearing. And there's nothing to prevent that, certainly in an open public forum, but it perhaps is more inappropriate than appropriate.
And we are pressed for time. That would be my reason to, we did get a late start. Is there someone else from the audience who would care to address this? No one? Oh, yes. Mrs. Perry.
My name is Rachel Perry, and I live at 10 Pine Ridge Road. My neighbors have pretty much said everything that I did want to say this evening, but I am still concerned about the claim that five or six consultants have actually walked this land and reviewed the wetlands. I don't know who Mr. Decker is referring to. May I ask him who he's referring to?
Mr. Decker could reply when you're finished. Just we'll leave that question so that we don't have it back and forth.
Okay. If he's referring to the EPA, I was there at the site walk. They walk as far as probably about here into phase two. They never made it anywhere in here. If he's referring to Colin Peters, who was hired by the neighborhood, I did also walk with him. He primarily spent his time in phase one, walked through here, and cut across, and did not study at all any of this area. I'm very concerned that, you know, you're being told that it's been reviewed several times. I don't know who these other consultants are. I would like to know if the Normando group has been at the site yet. Also, when the EPA did come for the site walk, they were here. I asked them if they were here to review the wetlands, and they said, no, we are here. Well, it was one person. It was Rodney Howe. I'm here to figure out which permits by rule the developer needs to apply for. And I know they did make a decision about our wetlands in here. He did say that yes, a certain area was a wetlands and that it had been a wetlands in 1987 also, according to the 1987 regulations. An eco-analyst, there was some debate there. I am also concerned, as my husband is, with the water runoff over here. We live in a valley, and I know darn well where this water is going to go if this cul-de-sac goes in. And having followed the new wetlands ordinance, I know that I will not be able to do anything to correct that drainage that will be coming into my backyard. And I don't really think that is very fair.
Thank you, Mrs. Perry. Is there anyone else from the audience who cares to address this? Not one other person. Well, seeing no one, I will close the public hearing, and perhaps this would be the right time for Mr. Decker to answer the question Mrs. Perry has asked, who are the five experts, if you have that information? And perhaps you could address any other questions or make any comments in reply to the remarks made by these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 speakers.
With respect to the last request on the number of consultants who have been on the site, I think the names were pretty much addressed and have been in the course of these planning board meetings, but eco-analysts, Woodlot Alternatives, Timpson, Sheps and Peters, Norman Dell, and the Corps of Engineers, five that I can think of right off quick, who have been on the site. And I know at least three of them have felt comfortable enough in what they have seen on the site to write reports and address the amount of wetlands on the site. With respect to a couple of other of the issues, the issue of the cul-de-sac here impeding the flow of water in the wetlands, that will not happen because this wetland surface flows water to the low-lying area down here. We're planning to install a culvert underneath the road here, which will allow the water to flow freely and not be impeded, and as well as
Excuse me. You're out of order.
And we have culverts planned under these driveways also to allow the water to flow as it does now. There were questions regarding the drainage, the inadequacies that Bob Hunter has addressed in previous correspondence. I would like to point out to the board that on March 12th, Mr. Hunter has responded to the most recent plans that have been submitted, as well as some of the previous plans also, and his last paragraph states that at this time there does not appear to be any substantive engineering issues that would not allow preliminary plan approval. So I feel as though those drainage issues have been adequately resolved at this point in time. Now there is also the issue of the ponding of water behind these houses on Hunts Point Road. If you look carefully at the contours, the flow of water is down through the wetland area, as one might guess that it would be. However, if any ponding were to occur adjacent to the road through here, we have planned for a roadside drainage ditch, a culvert under the road, and some ditching along this property line here to allow the passage of water through this area in that fashion. So we don't anticipate that the problem will be exacerbated. If anything, it'll probably improve the ponding situation. The concern about the wastewater disposal systems, these systems have been designed by a state-licensed site evaluator, and he has found soils on each of the lots that we have shown that do pass and are shown in the documentation. I'd like to also point out that each of the lots do meet the minimum square footage requirements that are in the town ordinances. There doesn't seem to be a problem there. I think that takes care of the issues that I noted.
Could I ask a question?
Sure, go ahead.
Scott, there was an allusion made during the public hearing to the fact that certain of the lots, certain of the lots are only going to allow certain size houses. Could you review those again and bring us up to speed on that?
Off the top of my head, I don't recall which lots those were. Perhaps Peter recalls, or not quick. There were two or three.
And what are the limitations there?
Ones. Yeah. It's in the record. The HHE 200 forms that the planning board has okay. does show those.
Madam Chairman, could we ask for the testimony about what those lots are? We've heard testimony from the public hearing that has addressed those, and maybe we should hear verbally from the applicant what that really means and what they're proposing to do.
Yeah. Good. If someone would raise his hand, I would acknowledge you.
That would be great.
And you could approach the microphone.
Madam Chairman, I'm Paul Frinsco. If I understand the question, it is, what does the applicant propose to do? The applicant proposes to conform to the state law, since nothing else can be done other than that is what is permitted by law. If the regulations of the Maine State Department of Health and Engineering limit a particular parcel to the construction of a two-bedroom dwelling, that's all that can be built there, and that's all that the local plumbing inspector may issue a permit for, and that's all the plans can show that come in for a building permit. If there would be a rubber band to go around the belt and suspenders that would respond more adequately to any concern, I'd be happy to review it with you. But it's very difficult to say.
Go, if I might.
Go ahead, Dick.
That's a given. All that you've just expressed is an absolute, and this board would expect that, and this board would
staff.
Expect the applicant to say just what you just said. The question was raised as testimony in the public hearing about certain lots being limited to number of bedrooms. The question that Mr. Most asked and that I've now brought up again, rather than receiving a response, that's in the application. I'm asking for the applicant to respond verbally tonight on the wetlands alteration permit application, which of those lots will be limited to the number of bedrooms.
I'd be happy to go through the HH200s and pick them out for you.
Fine.
I mean, they are a matter of record with this board,
and
I believe that they were accurately depicted, but I want to make certain that the reference in an earlier letter by lot number comports with the lot numbers on the existing plan before I go ahead and say that.
That would be
Bob's,
a good idea.
Bob's,
that would be an excellent idea, Mr. Frinsco.
But they may have changed.
Madam
Thank
Chairman,
you.
I would
go
think
ahead,
the applicant
Dick.
Should take as much time as they need to figure out which of the lots are limited.
Thank you, Mr. Dinsman. I appreciate your picking up on that. It's, you know, we get a lot of information, and we can't digest it all, and it's changed. So it's important that I understand where those limited lots are in this plan, especially as it relates to the change in the wetlands now. I'm very curious as to where those lots are.
Madam Chairman?
Yes, Steve.
On the same issue, it's a matter of record that twice before I've asked that the complete HHE 200 form is filled. That's a three-page form, and I've only seen so far to date one page of each one of those forms. I'll make it a matter of record that this is the third time that I've asked for the complete HHE 200 form to be filled out. I asked specifically, in order to make a good decision on these lots, that I needed to see what type of plan was being devised. I happen to be very capable of reading that form. I've read it for years. I think we have a right to have a chance to look at those.
Thank you, Steve. Any other questions from the planning board? Mr. Frinsco, could you please, I have recognized you now, could you please step to the microphone? And
so there won't be any mistake. I do not recall Mr. Etzel's request, and had you made it and I had recalled it, I would have made sure you saw it. My understanding is that with your staff, the original HHE 200s, and that they are complete and signed, each one, by a licensed soil evaluator. If you would bring them out, we'd be happy to respond to any questions you might have.
Steve?
Madam Chairman, in your possession.
We do have the all the materials that the applicant has submitted. I believe that Mr. Etzel is correct, though, in that only one of the sheet, which deals with the actual test pit locations, are provided. I can get the material and confirm that and allow the applicant to confirm that.
Anything else on this wetlands alteration permit. Yes, Tom.
Could the applicant just clarify, have the driveway entrances, any that cross wetlands, been included as part of the wetland alteration area?
Mr. Decker, do you want to come up to the microphone and address that?
Yes.
Thank you. Anything else? Dick?
Madam Chairman, is the applicant reviewing which of the lots are limited on number of bedrooms?
Are you? Or do you not have that information with you this evening?
I'm happy to do it. The material that I need to review is in your possession. I think Mr. Butler agreed to get it for us.
Oh, I see. So that's where he's gone. Okay. Any other questions while we're waiting for Mr. Butler?
Madam Chairman, I've got a couple of questions relating to the testimony tonight in the public hearing. One of the neighbors who testified this evening expressed concern for the area around the Channel View Road extension.
I think that was Mr. Woodworth, was it?
Well, there are a couple.
Uh-huh.
And the impacts of potential increased drainage resulting from that downhill onto lots that are along the Pine Ridge Road area. Two questions. One is whether or not there's been any analysis of potential runoff increasing for existing lots in the Pine Ridge Road area. Second question that I have is that there's a 30-foot drainage, 30-inch drainage easement shown on the plan. It should probably be 30 foot, but it shows as 30 inch, and I just noticed that. It's a dramatic difference between the two. A 30 inch or 30 foot drainage easement that runs along the boundaries of the properties that are located on Pine Ridge Road on the back side or northern side of the boundary of the applicant's property. I guess the question is, what does that drainage easement do? Is that to be sculpted in some way to allow the water to flow, or is that to be left in its natural state? And does it currently serve as a drainage easement?
Excellent question. Is the applicant prepared to answer that? Or
which easement are you talking about specifically, Dan?
Right where it says 30 inches, Scott.
On this plan?
I presume that it's on that plan. It's
just
to the north of your green area on the northwest, northeast.
I guess I'm not familiar with the easement at all, Dick. The one that where this 30-foot access easement, if that's what you're referring to.
Now, Scott, along the backside to the northern side of the property, on our plans.
Up here?
Yes. You can see a double line from here that shows what I'm sure measures out.
Okay.
Scales out to be a 30-foot easement.
This easement through here.
Right above there, you see some words that say 30-inch drainage easement.
Right.
That is the one, and I'm asking if it is inches or feet.
That is intended to be a 30-foot drainage easement.
One would presume that.
The purpose of that was originally to allow water when we had the full road through here. We were intending to discharge a fairly substantial amount of water down into this wetland area, and it was intended to carry that flow over to the major wetland. In the last couple of months, we have eliminated a section of road here, and the drainage calculations that we've developed to date don't indicate that there's going to be a significant increase in the amount of water that's going to be reaching this wetland. Again, these have all been reviewed by the town engineer and approved, and it is unlikely that there would ever be a need to construct a ditch through this area. That's why we're not showing it now. The easement is being left there should the town at any point in the future elect to do something, but it is not perceived to be a need at this point in time.
Madam Chairman,
Go ahead, Dick.
Mr. Decker did indicate that the engineer cited the engineer's closing comments, which I found surprising that our engineer would indicate that there are no technical basis for anything but approval for the application. And if that's an important issue, then I think we should probably have Mr. Hunter here so that we can ask him directly the questions that we're asking. But it seems to me strange that there will be no increase or minimal increase or not significant. I hear subjective terms, not objective terms, about increases in runoff when we have additional impervious surface in an area that's fairly sensitive. And as we walked down through there on Pine Ridge Road, very wet conditions existed throughout the area. I doubt, because of the resource protection nature of that land, which we've refused to rezone, that there'll be additional house lots in there, but there are some houses that are affected by the potential for increased runoff. If we have a drainage easement, I'm wondering why it's there. I hear Mr. Decker's comment that originally it was thought that the applicant was going to do some additional draining into this area, but I still don't hear what the increase is. We heard tonight about civil versus enough planning beforehand so that we didn't get into civil action matters concerning drainage. That area is of concern. I think that now that the wetlands appear to be as accurate as can be, and I think it's important for this board to say that from our standpoint and our consultant's standpoint, that there does seem to be agreement, and I would ask Steve Butler to comment on that issue so that there is no confusion about whether the wetlands boundaries have been determined or not. From what I understand as one board member, they have been determined, and that we are in at least agreement as far as the applicant and the town about where those wetland boundaries are, with our own experts reviewing their data. Still, there's an impact analysis that is raised tonight in a wetlands alteration permit application that I'm not convinced has been adequately addressed. Plus, the plan is incorrect. It's not a big issue, but when you see 30 inches versus 30 feet, that is an issue. Madam Chairman, I do have another question for Mr. Decker. On the southern part of the first phase, phase one, southern part of the site, there's a large wetland area that extends from where the Farm Pond Road enters into Hunts Point Road Extension, shown as your green area that parallels the first part, the bended part, the bent part of the street. It's a part of Lot 4, and it extends from wetlands that exist on the back side of the properties that are located on the south side of Hunts Point Road Extension down into the wetland area in Lot 4. You see that, Scott?
Talking about this area in
Yes.
unit?
Yes. That presumably serves as a natural drainage area, as a wetland for all of that area that has been expressed as being very wet by the neighbors who front on Hunts Point Road Extension. And my first question was why we don't have a drainage easement down through there to protect that drainage area as a wetland area, to preserve the movement of water down across there so that we don't leave that to the year 2000 and some private landowner deciding that they really want to do something different than we saw in 1990 as a planning board, or the applicant even anticipated happening when he put together the subdivision. Mr. Decker indicated that there is a ditch proposed along the northern boundary of that first phase from Farm Pond Road to the existing drainage area to the west. And as I understand the testimony, that would occur. Is that right? Which would alleviate some of the flooding that was indicated in our last public hearing by the owner of the property on the corner of the new road and Hunts Point Road Extension.
That's right.
That begs the other question, how is that ditch to be preserved and protected? There is no easement or any indication of other than the testimony, and I'm sure in some of these detailed drawings someplace that there's an easement.
I think there is on the detailed drawings.
But they're not showing up on the overall drawings. And that begs the question then, how is that ditch to be protected on these drawings that would have the planning board approval attached to them?
correct, that isn't labeled on this drawing.
Okay. The other question is, through lot, and the first issue is, through lot four, there is that existing drainage easement. And I don't know how much water moves and will move in that ditch that you've just cited, or how much would go down through the area that is the existing wetland area. But it would appear, just and from a non-technical basis, and I understand our engineers said there aren't any engineering basis for other than approval, but it appears just by looking at this that either an easement has to exist down through that piece, or that an analysis has to be done to show that this new ditch and easement will take care of any of the issues other than the flooding problems for an existing house.
I agree, Dick. I agree. Good.
There is an easement there, Dick.
It is shown on this drawing.
It doesn't appear to be shown in our drawing. There is one extending north-south down to the pond, but there isn't one extending east-west from the road over to that existing drainage.
Yeah, that's the one we just discussed. That's right. It's on the detailed drawings. It's not on this drawing.
Okay. It has to be on these detailed drawings, mm-hmm. obviously.
There is a 30-foot.
Any other questions, Ivan?
There is a 30-foot. Is that what you're referring to? 30-foot drainage shown by the corner of
just not labeled.
Okay.
Well, even of more
ahead,
concern
Dick.
Is an east-west.
Yeah.
You've mentioned a ditch running east-west from the road over to that drainage
right,
easement.
Right here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's intended to be a drainage easement.
Okay. That must be shown.
Ivan, do you have anything that you want to add?
Just curious whether we have any resolution to that question on the restricted lots. Are we anywhere on?
While we're waiting for the answer to that question, any other comments or questions?
Yes, I'd
Steve?
Like, Madam Chairman, also a resolution of the question whether the applicant intends to submit all three pages of the HHH 200 form for each site as was requested before.
Good. Thank you, Steve.
I'd be glad to respond
yes,
to that.
Yes, Mr. Frinsco.
The third page of the application, according to my recollection, is the actual final design and cross-section of the engineered system. That is not required by the town in any of its ordinances for preliminary plan approval. It is required in order to obtain the permit to install the system. The first two pages contain the engineering data upon which that design will be based, and set forth any limitations that would be included with respect to the final design. Since there are alternative designs of systems which may be installed, I have never had a request, and I honestly, Mr. F., I do not request you requesting page 3 of the HEC 200. I've never seen it done at this stage. It is usually the homeowner's option at that point in time, so long as the design is consistent with the first two pages, which are the engineering criteria for any of the alternatives chosen for the system.
Madam Chairman,
Steve?
The first time I asked for that, that the entire form be filled out, there was no response to that, and I just figured we would see that. There was next time we received the second large green book, there was more handwriting on the one page. That was the time that I addressed Mr. Kennedy and said, in order for me as one planning board member to make a wise decision about each one of these sites, especially the 15 sitting on with the marginal soils, I would like to see the completed form so I personally could make a good decision about each one of those. I will show you, and you can have this. This is the full 3 pages, plus the soils description and classification pages, really 4-page form, from the Meadowview subdivision that we just approved a few months ago. And I think when you take a look at it, you'll see how clear it makes each parcel and how much more clear it makes that decision. I was not trying to make you jump through hoops.
I
understand that. I understand. I just, there are a lot of things I like about this proposal before us, but I wanted to be able to make a good decision about each site. And in order to do so, I had asked now 3 times for a complete form to make that decision upon.
Thank you, Steve. Any other comments or questions? Yes, Tom.
Madam Chair, has the applicant set aside any additional property, upland area, to be act as mitigation for the loss of wetland area with the current proposal?
Mr. Decker, would you care to address that? Or Mr. Kennedy?
If I understand the question correctly, mitigation of wetland versus upland?
No, the question is that you're proposing to fill some area of wetland. Final determination of that is, I guess, yet to be made with future analysis in the spring. You're proposing to set aside some area of existing wetland and negotiating with the Conservation Commission. However, it's my understanding that EPA is promoting no net loss of wetland, and in doing so, what they're requiring applicants to provide is a mitigation proposal, if they allow you to fill it all, to replace the wetland that's been lost, so to speak, either on site or at another adjacent property.
I understand the question. No, we are not proposing to add additional wetlands to the property.
Thank you, Mr. Kennedy. Does that answer your question,
yes,
Tom?
Yes, it does.
Anything else on this? We're really running behind. According to our rules, we can take 30 days to vote on this. What are the pleasures and wishes of the planning board?
Madam Chair, yes. We still have an outstanding question, and I don't know if the applicant proposes to answer that or not.
From memory, on the two bedroom lots occur, lot 3.
These north?
North. And possibly 14. The information that someone gave testimony may be entirely correct as to the actual numbers of two-bedroom houses. I have to tell you, the market is terrific for two-bedroom houses. So I don't mind building two-bedroom houses whatsoever.
Mr. Kennedy, it's 3, 7, 4, and 14 from your memory?
3 and?
No, Dr. Sullivan says it's 3 and, 13 and, 5S, and 6S. I don't have Mr. Hunter's letter right in front of me. My only concern was to make certain that the references people are using are referenced to lot numbers as they appear on the final plan.
Yeah.
And not as they may have appeared. And the best way to do that is for us to check the actual test pit number on the test pit plan and see what lot that test pit falls on today. That's the best way to do that, to be certain that we're not.
Madam Chairman,
I
think that's an appropriate response, that if they don't know during the meeting, then they should say, we want to check into
right.
it, and we'll get back to you. And that's an appropriate response to mm-hmm. a question like that. And I think that's an acceptable.
Some of these lots you just mentioned seem to correspond with the lots cited by Mr. Timson. I can give you his full name. I think it's Dr. Barry Timson, who claimed that 10 of these lots could not meet the standards of subsurface disposal. He mentioned lots 1 and 2 and 10 and 11 and 12 and 13 and 14 and what used to be 15 and 4 south, 5 south, and 6 south. So I think a few of these do overlap with what he has mentioned, cannot cope with subsurface sewage systems at all. Any other questions? What are the wishes of, yes?
Just one more question, a point of clarification. You show on drawing Exhibit 3A, pond number 1, that has a triple heavy line around it. Could you indicate whether you're anticipating any filling within that area to create that pond, or what actually defines that pond? And does it have any retention or detention capability?
Referring to this line here? I mean this pond here?
Yes.
Okay. We do not intend to fill that pond at all. What we are doing is proposing a small ditch from the road down to the pond to discharge flows both from the existing drainage course here and a small portion of the road also.
What is indicated by the three heavy lines? What is the purpose of that on the plan, on Exhibit 3A?
Well, I'd better take a look at Exhibit 3A.
Madam Chairman, what is Exhibit 3A?
Revision D. It's the first page in the.
Merely to highlight the pond. They have no real significance.
Does that answer your question, Tom, or do you have
If I may, I'd like to address Mr. Tinsman's earlier comment with respect to the drainage easement. Deck, on drawing C-102, and I understand it's not the subdivision drawing, but the details of that drainage easement are shown, and it's merely an oversight that it hasn't got to this drawing yet.
That's what I had understood, and I would have expected that for the next meeting it will be changed.
Yes. And you still are confused, Tom? You do not...
Yes, I am. I suppose if I went out and saw that, is there an existing pond at that location? Is that what that's referring to?
Yes. Yes, there
that's
is.
That's what I thought.
Yep.
Thank you, Mr. Decker. As I said before, we do have 30 days. Does the planning board wish to take 30 days? Do I hear a motion?
Madam Chairman, I will move that, and I'll move the following. After I mentioned that the wetlands alteration permit application is before us, as is a subdivision application. Mm-hmm. And there may be issues that relate to the subdivision application that may change the subdivision application. I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be talking about that in about 2 minutes.
Right. That's what I was hoping, Mr. Tinsman.
Thank you. I understand, Madam Chair. And that we should hold any decision on the wetlands application until we've decided on the subdivision application.
Mm-hmm.
So I would think they're running tandem, appropriately so, and yep. that we would be voting on subdivision first and then wetlands alteration application. So with that in mind, that mm-hmm. I would move that we order that the application of the Highlands of Broad Cove, a 20-lot subdivision proposed by the Greater Portland Development Group for a planning board permit for wetland alteration, be tabled until the April 17th planning board meeting.
Thank you. Is there a second to that?
Second.
Second by Ivan Most. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? It's unanimous, Alice. Now, we will address the preliminary plan review. Janet, you have been given all of the information on this, but that was just a couple of weeks ago. You have been taken to the site. If you do not feel comfortable, we certainly will understand if you choose not to vote on this. We do have Steve Etzel, who would be willing to vote for you, but I will make it entirely your decision because I know that you have done your work.
I appreciate the question, Madam Chairman. Thank you very much. I have reviewed the applicant's submissions, but I have not had the privilege of hearing all the back and forth of the hearings for the last couple of times, and I understand we do have a very able member here who would be able to vote in my stead, and I would be perfectly happy to allow that to happen. So I move that Steve Etzel will be allowed to vote in my place on this particular issue.
Well, thank you. Is there a second to that?
Second.
All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? Steve, would you please vote? Thank you. Okay. Is there anything that the applicant would like to say? I would like to say that this evening when I got here, there were numerous submissions from the applicant, which, to tell you the truth, I did not have the time to read thoroughly. There is a time when submissions are to be made, and this planning board cannot vote intelligently when late submissions are given to us. I have studied what I knew about this subdivision, and I am not kidding you, for the on and off for the last 3 days. And then to come in here tonight and find a pile of papers submitted, one submission was dated tonight, I am sorry, I cannot cope with it. I don't know what the rest of the planning board feels. It isn't fair to the applicant or to anyone for us to read that quickly and attempt to assimilate this. Anyone else have any feelings on this?
Madam Chairman, I agree. And the first inclination that I had when I saw 6 or 7 or 8 letters was to immediately move to table. I'm not moving that right now.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we should do that this evening. I think it is, as you say, unfair to the applicant and to ourselves, and maybe even to the town engineer, who said that we have no basis for other than approval from an engineering standpoint, to at least look at the data that has now been submitted by the applicant and will be part of the record for this application wherever it goes from here. Before perhaps that motion is made, mm-hmm. I presume we have to have concurrence by the applicant in order to do that.
Yes.
Because we are required by ordinance to vote within so many days.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to take about 4 or 5 minutes, Madam Chairman.
Take as long as you like.
And walk through the inclinations that I have this evening to at least give the applicant a basis for whether or not they're inclined to agree to a tabling motion, and also to give them some feelings for the public record about the very standards that we have to maintain in this community for subdivision review.
Mm-hmm.
And like yourself, I spent a lot of time on this weekend because I knew that we would be voting this evening,
right,
to approve or deny or approve with conditions this application. And when you get to that point as a planning board member, you go to the standards that are in your ordinances to make sure that you have tested those standards against the burden of proof that the applicant has to provide data. My inclination coming into this meeting was to make a motion for denial of the application.
Mm-hmm.
And the inclination to do that is based on a review of the standards. I want to share that with the applicant. I will not be making a motion to deny because I want to review the new data that's come in, and it may change some of the thought process that I at least had coming into this meeting. There may be more data there that provides answers to some of the questions.
Mm-hmm.
Madam Chairman, if I may.
You may.
As you look at the standards in 16.3.1, General Standards of Subdivision Design, subsection B, deals with the planning board may require that minor streets be laid out so that their use by through traffic will be discouraged. We have talked a couple of times in this planning board about the need to reduce the impact of a potential through traffic coming through on Hunts Point Road Extension. That at one point in December was proposed by the applicant to change the design of the intersection of Hunts Point Road Extension and his new proposed Cove View Road so that through traffic would be more encouraged to go to Cove View Road rather than Hunts Point Road Extension. He has withdrawn that as an idea, I've mentioned this to the applicant. I almost feel like it's a little bit of a carrot, and then it gets dinged on a little bit by the engineers, and so decide not to do it. That isn't the only option. That was the only option that he proposed. We can only react to options and plans that the applicant proposes for the town. The other options were to do something with intersections further down on Hunts Point Road, intersection with Hunts Point Road Extension. That was not done. I would encourage the applicant to reconsider and revisit that, discouraging through traffic. There are other ways that through traffic can be discouraged. I came to this board tonight with a feeling that if for some reason there was strong evidence presented here, or if other members felt very strongly about approval of the application, that we should send a message to our town council that we believe in a secondary access for public emergency vehicles to the Broad Cove area. Mr. Decker mentioned at the beginning of his presentation that this road was primarily for the benefit of the community. In fact, it was primarily for the benefit of the applicant. This town has held for over a decade that there will be no further development approved by the planning board without a secondary access to Broad Cove. Mm-hmm. He doesn't have any approval for his Phase 2 or any other properties that don't exit out onto Two Lights Road unless it's a secondary access to the Broad Cove area. That's clear. That's a consistent standard that has been in this community for some time. Those are the rules. He knows the rules, and he has proposed to meet those rules. And I don't think he has any problem with that. Though a suggestion has come principally from Dr. Sullivan originally that this town look at a creative way of dealing with that secondary public access, I think that's appropriate. We've mentioned it to the applicant, and if it looked like this was going to be approved tonight, I would have moved that we approve the plan with the secondary public access, but also it having only emergency public use. And though that is a council decision, that we give that issue to them and for them to make a decision. And that would only be a recommendation on our part as a planning board. If they decided no, that would be a full-time public road, not for emergency use, then that is their decision. And we all work for the council as a community, and they work for the citizens. So
but they should be allowed options.
They should be allowed the options. So that's B. Yeah, there are many of these. And I'll try to skip through them quickly.
Don't go fast. This is very important. Take your time.
We're on tape, so you can listen to it again, because I'm sure some will. Plants and other types of vegetative cover shall be preserved or placed throughout and around the perimeter of the proposed subdivision. I think they've done that. Adequate buffer, reduction of noise and light, separation between the subdivision and abutting properties, and enhancement of its appearance. The applicant has proposed a screen buffer for the resident on the corner of his new farm Pond Road and Hunts Point Road Extension. I'm not sure whether that's an adequate buffer. I would look to that neighbor to give us some input on whether that is perceived as being adequate sufficiently for us to vote positively, and would ask through this forum that he consider that and comment. Subsection I of our standards, last part of that, says there shall be provided an easement or drainage right-of-way conforming substantially within the lines of such watercourses, culverts, catch basins, so that channeling surface water within such subdivision and over the property, the owner abutting upon it, of which nature, width, and location of the planning board, with the advice of the town engineer, deems adequate. I mentioned earlier this evening concern for an existing wetland that shows as natural drainage for an area that is along its northern boundary of Phase 1 and on the southern side of houses at front on Hunts Point Road Extension, that it would appear as though a easement within that lot 4 would be required, so that a resident, future resident, if it's approved of lot 4, would not have the option at some point to disturb that existing water flow. testimony tonight indicated that, at least from our subdivision plan, there is a ditch. They need to clean up the plans and show easements as well, coming east-west to that area. Subsection J, provision of pedestrian easements or other types of pedestrian access ways may be recommended to the applicant, where a pedestrian access way would add to the town's green belt system, or the planning board deems it important for public enjoyment or to provide access. And this board has indicated to the applicant that it deems it important for public enjoyment and access on the south side of the phase one portion of the subdivision for pedestrian access through there. That is an issue that may be fought out either outside this forum or within the forum, but at least from my perspective as one planning board member, I'm not willing to forego subsection J, our standards of subdivision review. We've indicated to the applicant that we desire that. I'll indicate as one member of the planning board that I will demand that as a requirement of the subdivision approval, at least for my vote. Subsection L indicates that each property shall be provided with vehicular access to the property by an abutting public or private street. We have issues of waivers that are before us for road frontage. That's an issue that has not been discussed a great deal as a planning board. I'd indicate that though I don't, that I'm not troubled by that particular provision and the request for that waiver, that it goes without saying that waiver requests do require special attention by board members, and they're not granted on a willy-nilly basis. Subsection O of our standards requires, and it's a long paragraph, I won't read it. The essence of it is that the subdivider, whenever practical, should be required to preserve natural features. A great deal of that deals with marshes, swamps, and other matters. This is a very wet site. The applicant has appropriately dedicated certain amounts of land, either through drainage easements or for open space. Perhaps that is not sufficient to meet any deficiencies, as was raised by neighbors' testimony during our public hearings over the last couple of months. One of the sections of this subsection O says the planning board may require the subdivider to dedicate such features to joint ownership and management by the owners of individual lots, homeowners association, condominium association, or the planning board may accept dedication to the town itself or an appropriate third party. That whole issue to me relates to the issue of the southern wetlands and the need to provide, again, pedestrian access through and protection of what was cited by their own consultants, eco-analysts, as being the highest value wetland in the subdivision for a number of purposes, including high ranking for wildlife breeding and migration, sediment retention, and toxic retention. And moderate ranking for groundwater discharge, flood flow alteration, sediment stabilization, nutrient removal, protection, production export, which I have no idea which means, and aquatic diversity. And with that high and moderate ranking as a wetland area, they're still proposing it be in private ownership, for which over the next 20, 30, 40, 50 years, individual lot owners make the decisions on what happens there, even in spite of the town's wetlands ordinances that might be in effect at that time, simply because the policing powers of this community don't look at every lot every week of every year. And it's incumbent on this board, I believe, and on this town to adequately protect its wetlands at the beginning of a process and not let individuals at some future point in time do something different than was anticipated by the applicant on a very good basis. I mean, he has the best of intentions. I think we have the best of intentions, and we've got to match those intentions somehow. Subsection Q deals with the requirement that the planning board shall require the subdivider to provide an area suitable for recreation or open space purposes up to 10% of the subdivision's total land area. Land reserved for primary, scenic, or passive recreation purposes shall have sufficient public access as determined by the planning board. Again, to me, that relates not only to the northern wetlands but the southern wetlands, and I would have to answer that question no, that the applicant has not provided sufficient recreation or open space land sufficient to meet the test of the burden of proof, at least in this planning board member's mind. Subsection R deals with common open space recreation areas and other areas to be dedicated by the applicant should be maintained to ensure that its use and enjoyment is not diminished or destroyed. With the applicant submitting written documents identifying which individual group or organization shall be responsible for said maintenance. As late as tonight, as I read through this material quickly before the meeting that was presented by the applicant, there's again discussion about if you don't want the land on the northern side, then we'll give a fee instead of that land. That has been a confusing issue throughout this process. Let it be clear from this planning board member's mind that I like what the applicant has provided and proposed for the northern wetland area. I'm a little concerned by the public access and the public areas and the rights of certain people to traverse that area. That came up in testimony tonight, even though it was a wetlands alteration public hearing. It was
It's all very related.
It's still unclear, and there's still some, at least, documentation by the applicant dated as late as within the last day or the last few hours or the last couple of days that there's confusion about who's going to have that land and what does the planning board want to do about it. I think that his proposed dedication is appropriate. I would expect him, as an applicant, to do the same thing for the southern wetlands. To the issue of S, all systems proposed for disposal of sewage for developments regulated by this ordinance shall be governed by the provisions of Chapter 15. We have a report prepared by a consultant for the neighbors, the Timpson Report, dated December 18, 1989, which indicates that there are 11 lots that would not pass the state test. The applicant has verbally indicated that that test is not appropriate under town standards. This applicant, Dr. Timpson, is saying that it does. What do you believe? Well, you can believe, I guess, either one. But the burden of proof is on the applicant, and the burden of proof must be backed up by not only verbal indications, but by citations, if that's what's required, hydrogeologic reports, if that's what's required, or whatever else. There are 11 lots that do not appear to meet the test for sewage disposal for subsurface systems. And the burden of proof has not been at least adequately defined, in my view, until we get a response to Dr. Timpson's letter. The issue of the HE200, for which our colleague on my left sits in better understanding than I do, is an issue that has to be resolved. He was explaining it to me as the applicants were looking at it, and I'm not even sure page one was presented on a consistent basis, and I think we need to go back and look at that to see about the HE200s. Notwithstanding that, the Barry Timpson report has not been adequately addressed. The burden of proof has not been adequately presented, at least to this one board member. And I'm taking too long, Madam Chairman.
That's all right.
Subsection T, the planning board shall review all subdivision proposals to assure that they are designed to minimize flood damage, that adequate drainage is provided so as to reduce exposure to flood hazards. I'm not convinced that on the northern side of the Phase 2 subdivision proposal, and I haven't seen enough data, and I don't understand all of the issues of engineering reports, but I think we need to ask Bob Hunter, and I would request that he is at our next meeting so that we can say that that drainage area along Pine Ridge Road, is he convinced that there will be no further flooding or no increase in flooding that could result in civic damages or civil damages being filed against the town or against the developer or against some property owner in the future. If he's willing to sit here as our engineer and say that, then I would expect that we would be okay. We have to look to him to address those issues. And through the chair, I would request that the town planner request Mr. Hunter to be in attendance at the next meeting so that we can address that issue as well as other issues in the application. Subsection U deals with any proposed alteration of wetland shall adhere to the requirements and standards of the zoning ordinance. I'm not convinced that with the information that we have, given the other things that I've indicated tonight, that that is adequately addressed. That's why I propose we handle these in tandem, and we only deal with the wetlands alteration once the subdivision approval is granted. Mm-hmm. And then we have a final design to make sure that the application that we have is based on that final design for preliminary plan approval. And section V, subdivider shall make adequate provision for the protection of wildlife habitat and fisheries areas, which may include but are not limited to maintenance of wildlife travel lanes and to the preservation and buffering of wildlife habitat areas from proposed development activities. We have not only the testimony of neighbors in the Broad Cove area, but the eco-analyst reports that also suggest that there are travel corridors, there are issues with apple orchards, there are issues with areas that need to be protected. Those areas that most need to be protected and have the highest value are going to end up in private landowners' lots, for which that private landowner presumably has the right, within guidelines of town ordinances, to do anything they want with the land. I think that is it's almost a sham. I think that it needs a protection device surrounding those high-value wetlands for wildlife breeding. And again, that deals with the southern wetlands issues. So, Madam Chairman, those are quickly running through, spending days and looking through this applicant, looking at the months of material and the various maps that have been submitted to us. I would hope that, given what I've said and maybe other board members here tonight, that the applicant will come back with a more sensitive plan, one that recognizes these concerns. And I didn't touch on some issues that have been raised by other board members at the next meeting. Mm-hmm.
I think you touched on most of them, and very intelligently, Dick. And I worked for days. I went through the ordinances as you did, and had to smile at some of your conclusions because I reached them too. This project at this moment in time is indeed a candidate for denial until some deficiencies and concerns are seriously addressed by the applicant. You've put a lot of work into this, a lot of money has gone into this, and it would be for the good of the town, yourself, everyone, if these deficiencies and concerns were addressed. In addition to some of the concerns discussed by Dick, I would just like to say that this board respects the constitutional rights of the applicants who appear here before us. But we also have to listen to the people. Otherwise, our public hearings are a farce. And then we must weigh all of that information and be totally objective. In the 5 years I have been here, I have never seen this board not be totally objective. And I would just like to cite some things that were said that really constitute evidence, clear evidence by the people of Cape Elizabeth and some of the people who were hired by a group of people. One was mentioned, Mr. Barry Timpson, who provided evidence concerning 10 or 11 lots that are inadequate for sewage disposal. The burden of proof is on the applicant concerning the evidence presented. I could go through, I did for about 6 hours, I went through all of the testimony, Dr. William D'Angelo, the physician who gave evidence that he treats people who are trauma cases, who are hit on busy thoroughfares, and evidence by Mrs. Natalie Stoddard concerning the rare species and the herons and the red-shouldered hawk and the quail and the pheasant and the woodcock, foxes, and mink. And there is evidence that there is flooding, that there are serious drainage problems in this entire area. We have had evidence for quite some time that the septic systems in this area failed. That is why it was sewered. We have evidence concerning dangers onto Lights Road, namely evidence that just came in today that there were two rollovers on Wheeler Road at the blind curb that we've been talking about for so long. We have evidence that there is flooding on Two Lights Road. I don't know what can be done about that, but that's certainly something that you're going to have to look into. We have evidence that there are 20,128.4 cars which visit Two Lights State Park, and I could go on and on with the wildlife and plant species and all sorts of drainage problems, serious drainage problems throughout this entire area. So with that, I will ask if anyone else on the planning board has anything else to say about this preliminary plan. Yes, Judith.
Yes, first I'd like to ask, I have forgotten, have we tabled this already?
No.
We haven't.
No.
I came here tonight prepared to deny it. That was my feeling. And I had many of the same feelings that Dick articulated so well. I got down to about 8 and said, well, my mind's made up for now. Primarily around the open space, the southern open space is for me a particular problem, the skating ponds, as I've referred to them.
Yeah, which you mentioned at the last meeting when Mr. Kennedy wasn't here.
The drainage, the properties that face on the southerly side of Hunts Point Road, I know them. I know the way they've been pushed in. It's a real, filled in, it's a real nightmare in there. The piece of property itself is probably one of the most beautiful pieces of property in Cape Elizabeth, but it is an absolute craziness to try to come up with a really good plan that works. I think what we have here now is we started off with something and it gets a little bit changed and a little bit changed and a little bit changed, and from a very subjective point of view, I almost want to say just come back with something completely different. We've stuck things all over it, trying to scotch tape, band-aid, and fix little problems as they come up. Parenthetically, I also want to commend Dr. Sullivan, who has throughout this long procedure always had alternatives and good ideas, and I really appreciate that when you have a criticism but you also have an answer or a proposal, and it's not just always negative. Thank you. Which brings me to my next thought. Does the applicant think he can get all these? I don't know how the rest of the board is feeling. Is it worthwhile to have us all come back again next month and go through the same thing and then deny it if he doesn't answer these questions? Unless they're fixed, my vote's not going to change. Should we vote to deny it now? Let him go back, save some more money from everybody. I mean, it's enough money's been thrown at this right now to. But anyway, that's my thought. Maybe we should just put it to bed and start again in a couple of months with a new plan. Or maybe we should table it.
What are the feelings
Ivan? Before we get to that decision, I came tonight prepared to do something, I guess, different than some of my other planning board members. And I'm really discouraged at this point in time that I really can't do that. Frankly, I felt that this development, Broad Cove, in my 20 years living in town, has really been a time bomb from a public safety point of view. I feel that the second access road, full access road to Broad Cove, is necessary and needed and way overdue. I'd hate to have it on my conscience as a planning board member that some public disaster happens that closes that road off that causes some significant problems for the people who live there. What distresses me is that this plan has not progressed to the point of time that I could vote for it. There are significant technical issues that have been raised tonight that just prevent me from doing that. And so I would have to, if we came to a vote tonight, I'd have to deny.
I wouldn't want to do that. I really feel very strongly about the second access. I feel very strongly about a real second access to Broad Cove. I think it's an important public safety issue for this town. And so at this point in time, I'm distressed by the turn of events that have occurred that have clouded the vision, both the increased wetlands is one area, and some of the questions that have been raised tonight. So I feel distressed that we have to go in a different direction.
Thank you, Ivan. Anyone else?
Just briefly,
Steve.
Madam Chairman. I have very similar opinions and thoughts, echoing most of what Richard summarized. I think I somehow sense that the developer or the applicant didn't expect a vote tonight after seeing the pile of five or six additional items. I don't think they can think that we can make a decision or at least consider those additions at this time. We've all stated additional items that need clarification, and I think we have the ultimate right to demand the best possible. I said before that there are a great number of things about this application that I like. There are some very positive things about the plan as it has developed. I think there are a few remaining articles that we certainly have the right to demand that they're clarified. We have the duty serving the town to ask for those. I think it's a board decision whether we decide to go on beyond this point to deny it or to table it at this time.
Dick, how do you?
Madam Chairman, I may have seemed to be negatively biased against the application. I am not. I would vote to approve the applicant the application with the answers to the questions and the resolution of the issues that I raised. I think that should be clear. So no one goes out of here tonight and I'm against this proposal. I am not.
Right.
I'm against the proposal as it's now constituted. I guess the question, and Madam Chairman, I will move to and with that as an explanation, I would move to table, but I want to ask the applicant first whether the extension of time is appropriate for them or whether they, and we need agreement before we can do that. And if not, then I'll make a motion to deny, and they can start all over.
Okay. Would you please pose the question to Mr. Kennedy? What are your wishes this evening?
To the applicant, then, you've asked the question.
Mr. Kennedy.
If there are any. My understanding is the decision is being put off for a month. If that's what I've been requested to consider, Mr. Kennedy has said by all means, if you'd like this new time, fine.
Madam Chairman,
are there any other conditions that we should be aware of?
Madam Chairman, reason for tabling this motion, or my moving to table this motion, would be for us to review data that was put in front of us this evening.
Oh, fine.
If there are no other changes that change any of the basis that I've spent 15 minutes going through our standards, and no changes to the ordinance, then I would be moving to deny this application and put it to rest. That month will allow us to review what Mr. Kennedy has given us this evening. But it will also give Mr. Kennedy, it will give us the time to review this. It will give Mr. Kennedy the time to consider the statements that were made this evening and make any revisions to the preliminary plan that he feels are necessary in order to secure approval.
Dick got right to the point that I was trying to suggest I wanted to hear, and that is whether or not what time standard is the board going to impose to address more specifically the issues which have been raised by planning board members this evening, and whether or not the board, having found the application to be complete, is going to request additional information from the applicant on any one of these issues. Request by the board rather than what we would proffer.
I don't know how you want to answer that question, if I've made myself clear. If I haven't, please let me know.
Madam Chairman, maybe yes, to clarify the first question, I think the applicant's attorney is asking the board, are you saying that things have to be done in a month, or if the applicant and I, or is there perhaps more time needed? I might advise the board to maybe ask the applicant how much time he thinks is needed to address, to adequately address all the concerns that were raised.
And to meet the burden of proof.
Right.
Well, my real question is whether or not your usual submission rules apply in this situation. I've forgotten how many days that is in advance of a meeting, but it is well in advance of a
18
meeting.
18 days, which would mean that if we're aiming for April 17th, we'd be looking at March 30th.
And if that's the board's position, then it's far be it for me. I don't know how to respond. I have to ask the technicians to respond. I can respond to many of Mr. Tinsman's points, which I think can be resolved by appropriate restrictive language, either on the form of a plan restriction, a deed restriction, or some recorded covenant. That is typically on a final plan approval. If that would be of assistance at preliminary plan approval, we certainly can provide that type of alternatives, knowing that you folks want your counsel to review these things. Choose a policy approach, and then we'd have final language approved by your counsel, as you request. With respect to any engineering details, I'd have to turn to the consultants because it would be inappropriate for me to respond to that. I hate to put you on the spot, but I'm not able to say how long it takes you to do your work.
Madam Chairman, can
yes,
I just
Steve.
Interject something here? Just as one planning board member, I'm not sure that the amount of time, certainly there are parameters, but I think the quality of what we received back, we made it quite clear the issues that we need to have clarified to make good decisions. Whether it takes 30 days or 60 days, I think that's a mutual agreement. I don't certainly have a time table set here. I have more of a concern for the quality of our decision than I am for, well, we've got to have it done in 30 days. If it's an issue where it takes 25 days for the engineer, that's fine. We go into the second month.
In reality, for us, 30 days is really 12 days.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's why I need to ask these folks what they really need to get an appropriate response, unless Mr. Tinsman's motion is limited to April 17th. I didn't get the sense that it was from his comments. So.
If I may just break in, though, Mr. Frisco, I think some of the points that Mr. Tinsman raised, are policy issues. I don't think they have anything to do with design. I mean, we're talking about proper use of recreational space, access. These are decisions I think that, you know, if they're made, they could be easily made within 12 days, or if they're not going to be made, then maybe we're just, beating our head against the walls at this point in time. We should know it. So I think there's some serious policy issues. The design issues, I understand, those can take time. But, can you address some of the policy issues that were raised tonight in the 12 days that are
Oh, clearly, that does not require more than perhaps a night of reflection. But the technical translation of the applicant's response to those policy questions into what this board has traditionally required, and appropriately so, in the form of documentation, is not within my ability or Mr. Kennedy's ability. That's why I turned to Squaw Bay and say, look, folks, you've got to give us an estimate whether 30 days or 60 days is appropriate.
Yes, I think we touched on many of these deficiencies and concerns 30 days ago, and an extension of time was given. That was one. And I have seen very little changed.
Madam Chairman, the only
yes.
reason for the proposed tabling motion is for us to have the option to review data that was submitted tonight.
Tonight.
I wouldn't want to vote on an issue when data was submitted, even though it was submitted inappropriately.
Mm.
At least have the applicant have that. I'd like to cut through all of the words, get on with the issue,
mm-hmm.
and mutually agree to an extended period of time or not,
mm-hmm.
and move that issue.
What would you We're really running late. Could you, decide how long you think you need to address these issues, Mr. Kennedy, in a realistic manner?
Mr. Kennedy has suggested that it would be appropriate to put this off for two meetings. If I am correct, two monthly meetings. Not 60 days, I don't believe. I think you meet on a day of the week. I don't know what your May meeting is.
Mr. Frinsco, could you speak up? The people in the audience can't seem to hear you. I think you just said that...
Is this on?
Okay.
Two meetings?
The suggestion is, in order to allow you adequate time to review materials, is to make it for the May meeting. I think Mr. Tinsman's motion referred to the April meeting. We're suggesting the May meeting would be more appropriate in response to your inquiry. I just don't happen to know.
The May meeting would be May 15th, with the submission deadline being April 27th.
That would be fine.
Madam Chairman.
Yes.
I would move that we table the application of Highlands Broadville 20 lot subdivision proposed by Greater Portland Development Group for subdivision preliminary plan review until the May 15th meeting.
A second.
Is there a second?
A second.
Oh, Steve. Any discussion of this? Any discussion? Judith?
I have a misconception here, perhaps, but under the rules of order, can't something be tabled for only one meeting? It can be postponed, but not tabled. I'm just having problems with the semantics, perhaps, but...
It's a good point.
If that's what we can do is table it, then we can only table it for one meeting.
Notwithstanding our own rules, which Steve is looking at, a motion to table can be till a time certain, regardless of the amount of time that it takes, and that has to be tested by the individuals making the motion and taking the vote. Our own rules may be different. You may be absolutely right.
This May meeting would afford more opportunities to view the land now that the snow has gone too, should that be necessary.
It appears as though the board could push forward reconsideration of this issue to a time that was mutually agreeable, next meeting or 2 months from now or what have you.
Or 3 months.
Three, six.
So the motion stands then.
Okay. Steve seconded it. We just had a question about it. Any discussion? All in favor of Dick's motion, raise your hand, please. Against? Okay. Judith, Kane, opposed. The rest of us, four. Well, thank you very much. I thank all of you people for coming out.
Madam Chair, there's one small point.
What?
There's one small point, if I may.
Oh, sure.
You have the
just a moment, please. This hasn't ended. Go ahead, Mr. Frinsco.
It might be appropriate that, if I recall, some of the policy suggestions by board members that they wanted to deal with the wetlands issue at the same time they deal with the subdivision. The wetlands issue presently is tabled until the 17th of April. You may wish to proceed with making these.
That's consistent. Thank you. Thank you. We get so befuddled.
That's an appropriate suggestion.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, I make a motion we line the wetlands application with the preliminary plan application at the same for the same meeting. So
both will be on May 15th.
Right.
Is there a second to that? Any discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? Okay, that's unanimous. Thank you all very much for coming, and we'll see you in, everyone else will see you in May, Mr. Kennedy. Would the board care to take a break, or do you want to go on with the next one? I think people need a break. The planning board will take a very brief break, and we'll be right back. Thank you very much.